يلا.
بسم الله، اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على آل محمد. Last time we stopped with this hadith, yeah, the hadith of Jabir bin Abdullah. Narrated Jabir bin Abdullah regarding the description of the Hajj of the Prophet. He said, and the Prophet said, begin with what Allah has begun with. We stopped in this hadith, yeah? We said the reason why the Prophet has said this hadith, begin with what Allah has begun this, with what Allah has begun with. The Prophet stood up in Safa. When you go to Hajj, you do tawaf between Safa and Marwa. So the Prophet stood up on the mountain of Safa, and he said this statement. He said, begin with what Allah began with. ابدأوا بما بدأ الله به. He started from Safa, not from Marwa. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إن الصفا والمروة. He didn't say إن المروة والصفا. So the Prophet started with what Allah has started with. But he said a general statement. He said, start with what Allah has started with. Begin with what Allah has begun with. This is general. Even though he said it when he was on Safa, but the statements of the Prophet has to be taken generally. So every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran starts with something, we have to start with what Allah has started with. Why did he mention this in the book of Wudu? Why did he mention this hadith in the big book of Wudu? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ. Wash your faces, your hands to the elbow, wipe your head, and then your feet. So, because of this order of the Prophet, there is different opinion amongst the fuqaha. If someone can, for example, wudu, start with his feet, and then his face, and then his hand. There is different opinion. According to the Ahnaf, for example, it's fine to start with the feet and then the face. Because of this hadith here, start with what Allah has started with, it's an order. So we have to go to start wudu the way we are doing it today, the way that everybody does it today, starting with the face, then the hand, then the head, then the feet. If you do it in a different way, you would be contradicting this hadith that the Prophet said when he was in Hajj. You know this rule in fiqh, al-ibratu bi'umum al-laf la bi-khusus al-sabab. We look at the general saying of the Prophet, we don't look at the specific reason why he said what he said. You know this rule. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Quran, for example, لا يحسبن الذين يفرحون بما آتوا. Don't think that those who are happy or celebrate or are happy with the things that they have done. ويحبون أن يحمدوا بما لم يفعلوا. And they like to be praised with the things that they have not done. If you go to Sahih Bukhari, there is Marwan ibn al-Hakam told Ibn Abbas, if Allah will judge everybody who is happy with the things that he has not done, then we will be all punished. We all are happy with the things that we have done. Not happy, to be praised with the things that we have not done. Like someone who doesn't pray much, doesn't give charity much, but when people start praising him because they think he is doing this, and he is happy, he gets happy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has threatened these people that they will be punished. Now when Marwan bin al-Hakam, probably he had this problem, we don't know, sent to Ibn Abbas asking about this, Ibn Abbas said, oh no, this ayah was revealed about the Jewish. But then when you go to the books of tafsir, they will say, yeah, Ibn Abbas said this. It is being revealed about because of some Jewish who were happy about the things that they have done, but the ayah is general. Is general like the ayah that says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. After Allah has mentioned the people of the book, He mentioned the people of the book first, and then at the end He said, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ. And whoever doesn't rule or judge according to what Allah has revealed. He didn't say, and whoever amongst the Jewish judge. So it's general. Even though before he said this, he was talking about the Jewish, but we take the general wording. Hamukallah. Yeah, we take the general statement of the of Allah or of the Prophet. We don't look at the specific
scenario
where it happened. This is agreed open by the fuqaha that we shouldn't, except when it comes to practice in specific cases, individual cases. Sometimes they tend, sometimes in some cases they tend to say, oh, this is specific, it was revealed in specific place, or, but generally this is the rule. This is how the Quran, even though it's small in volume, this book is small in volume, covers everything that we need in this life. This is how, because you take the general, the wording generally. Yeah, asbab al-nuzul. It doesn't make any changes. Even if we don't know asbab al-nuzul, it's still we have to take the general meaning of. We know the here as why the Prophet said, "Began with what Allah has begun with." He said it because he was in Safa and Marwa. But this ayah we use it everywhere. This hadith we use it everywhere. Every time we want to practice an ayah from the Quran, we see first what Allah has said. We don't go conservative, like in wudu. It is haram because of this hadith to start with the hands. For example, someone is doing wudu and he starts with his hands, and then he does the face. If he continued his wudu this way, his wudu is invalid. Now he washed his face, he must go back to his hands and do it in order. Sayyidun Tayyiba, famsahu bi wujuhikum wa aydikum. How did the Prophet do tayammum? Those who described the Prophet tayammum, how did he do? He did this. He blew the dust from his hand, and then he did this. Famsahu bi wujuhikum, your faces and then your hands. You have to do it like this way. You start with your hand, and your tayammum is invalid. Every time you practice, you apply an ayah, you start with what Allah has started.
Sheikh, also by Sheikh said, the tayammum is invalid. Doing the face and doing this.
That is qiyas.
Yeah.
Against the hadith. That is only the Ahnaf do that. The Malikis, the Hanbalis, the Shafi'is, Madhab, it's just the...
After the face, you just rub the hand.
No?
After the face, you just rub the hand.
Yeah, these hands. Of course, if you do qiyas, you have to do it here, because this is replacing the wudu. So you have to do it here. But this is here, the majority choose not to apply qiyas in this case. Anyway, anything regarding this hadith? Okay, we go to the next hadith. And narrated from Jabir bin Abdullah, the Prophet used to run the water down his elbow while performing ablution. Jabir ibn Abdullah narrated, not well, if Jabir narrated it, it will be sahih, of course. Huh? We say this, Jabir ibn, it has been narrated that Jabir, it has been said that Jabir said that the Prophet ran the water down his elbows while performing ablution. This hadith is narrated by Darqutni. This hadith is narrated by Darqutni, and the isnad of this hadith is da'if, is weak. Is weak is not, this is one of the hadith that it's agreed upon by the muhaddithin. The muhaddithin agree that this hadith is da'if. It's so da'if that almost everybody agrees that it's da'if. What this hadith, what difference will this hadith will make? He says that the water that he ran, the water on his elbow, here, so that he washed this area. All the description of the Prophet, of the wudu of the Prophet, the hadith of the Prophet, it says that the Prophet used to wash his hands to the elbow, to the elbow. And the hadith of Abu Huraira himself, he used to wash up to this area, beyond the elbow, which shows that the elbow is covered as well. Because there was a different opinion about this, whether the elbow should be covered or not. Now the Quran say, وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ. Wash your hands to the elbows. To the elbows, according to the Arabic language, إِلَى, means to this area. It doesn't have to cover the elbow, because إِلَى is not مَعَ. Is the meaning of إِلَى, meaning to the, if I say I am going to the mosque, to the mosque, if I go to the door of the mosque, I am going to the mosque. I don't have to go to the mosque and cross the mosque to say I have gone to the mosque. You understand? So إِلَى, this to the elbow doesn't have really, according to the Arabic language, to cover the elbow. But the majority say the elbow has to be covered. Not because of this ayah, because the Prophet, the description of the wudu of the Prophet, those who described the Prophet ablution, nobody says that he used to stop next to the elbow. Some didn't explain, they said to the elbow exactly the way the ayah said. Some said that he used to wash the elbow. But not really clear the way this hadith mentioned it. That's why he brought here the hadith which is weak. I told you the majority say that the elbow has to be covered. Sibawayh, one of the most known people in Arabic language, but he is as well, he has his opinions in fiqh and hadith, and his opinion are taken and he is trustworthy. The fuqaha take his opinion. So Sibawayh, Abu Bakr bin Dawud, and Zufar from the Ahnaf say the elbow doesn't have to be covered with water. But everybody else say it has to be covered.
What did they take?
They take that the description of the Prophet. They say the way the Prophet and the hadith of Abu Huraira, when he did wudu to up to the and he passed the elbow, and then he said the Prophet said that my ummah will come the day of judgment ghurran muhajjalin, with marks on their heads, and tahjil is marks on the feet or on the hands. It just really all these hadith show that it is good to cover the elbow, but there is no strong evidence to say that the elbow has to be covered with water, with, yes.
I don't know if it's a weak hadith, but the hadith of Aisha, where Aisha said that the Prophet's elbow, she saw that water was dripping from his elbow. So could that be
dripping from?
Yeah, from his elbow.
Hadith of Aisha saying that the hadith, I don't know this hadith. This you have to think about, probably you are mentioning hadith of different hadith, or dripping from the water dripping yeah. from his head,
no,
from his beard, from dripping was water dripping from his elbow.
Meaning that it reached there.
Not really. If there was such hadith, I can't think now of any hadith from Aisha water dripping from his elbow. But water when you are doing wudu, water goes down sometime. Can't control it. So sometimes it goes to the elbow. It's a question of the water dripping from the elbow here doesn't mean anything. Definitely when the Prophet, there is so many hadith that shows that the Prophet used to do wudu up to the elbow. So the water, he's not going to control it and stop it like from going to the elbow. Understand? And we say that there is so many hadith that may look like the elbow has been covered with water. However, this is action. This is what we're talking here. It's an action of the Prophet. He is just applying the ayah. The ayah that says that you have to wash your hands to the elbow. And this is here where the difference of opinions comes. It's not question of whether the elbow should be covered, is good to cover the elbow or not. It's question of if it's an obligation. An obligation is not to be taken from the action by itself. An obligation is to be taken from the saying of the Prophet. We have spoken about this before. When Prophet does something, it won't be an obligation. Except in some people of some fuqaha say, if it's an explanation of an order, it will be an obligation. Like in this case, that's why the different of opinions came. Yeah, but that hadith, I don't know really which hadith you are talking about, but yeah, just check it again. Yeah. Now, narrated Abu Huraira, Allah Messenger said, there is no wudu, meaning abolition, for one who does not mention Allah name, open it. Alaykum as-salam wa barakatuh. Now, he says here, reported by Ahmed, Abu Dawud, and Ibn Majah, with a weak chain of narrators. At-Tirmidhi reported something similar to the above from Sa'id ibn Zayd and Abu Sa'id. Ahmad said, there is nothing authenticated concerning this matter. Ahmad ibn Hanbal saying that there is nothing authenticated concerning the matter of mentioning the name of Allah at the wudu. I think that what he means here is this, la wudu'a, there is no wudu for someone who didn't mention the name of Allah. This hadith is considered to be sahih by Al-Hakim because he made a mistake. He narrated it from Ya'qub ibn Abi Salama, from his father, from Abi Huraira. So he mentioned the person he narrated this hadith from, the chain of narrators, he mentioned someone, Ya'qub ibn Abi Salama, from his father, from Abi Huraira. Ya'qub ibn Abi Salama, from his father, is a man of Bukhari. Ya'qub ibn Abi Salama. Bukhari narrates from this man. However, the mistake here is that Al-Hakim made is because this person is not Ya'qub ibn Abi Salama. The person who narrated this hadith, Ya'qub ibn Salama, not ibn Abi Salama. But he made a mistake. He mixed them together, mixed up. So he thought this hadith is sahih. But this hadith is da'if because Ya'qub ibn Salama and his father are unknown. So this hadith is da'if, and this is what Ahmed said, that there is no authentic hadith in this matter. There is hadith that is narrated by An-Nasa'i with a chain of narrators that is authentic according to Bukhari. In that hadith, the Prophet said, the Prophet was sitting with his companions, and then the time of prayer came, and then he called for some water, he asked for some water, they brought the water. So the Prophet said, Tawadda'u bismillah. Do your ablution in the name of Allah. This hadith is sahih according to the condition of Bukhari. All the men on this hadith are man of Bukhari. But what's the difference between this hadith when Ahmed ibn Hanbal say there is no hadith sahih concerning this matter, when this hadith is sahih that the Prophet said do wudu in the name of Allah, which makes doing wudu in the name of Allah an obligation? So it's either Ahmed ibn Hanbal didn't know this hadith, this is one, or what he meant here is the fiqh that we can take from these two different hadith is different. When the Prophet say do wudu in the name of Allah, it make the wudu an obligation. The wudu will be obligation. But let's say someone has forgotten to name Allah, to say Bismillah, his wudu will be still valid. But if he say there is no wudu for someone who didn't mention the name of Allah, that means if a person does wudu and he didn't mention the name of Allah, his wudu is invalid. You see, when the Prophet say there is no prayer without wudu, there is no prayer without wudu or without al-Fatiha. So if someone forget and stand up and pray without wudu, we say that he must do wudu again and do prayer again. It's not, you have to look at the words of the Prophet very carefully. Do wudu in the name of Allah is not like there is no wudu for someone who didn't mention the name of Allah. The first one will make it a condition. This is just merely an order. You see, if you stand up for prayer, do the adhan and do iqama. So adhan and iqama is an obligation. If you don't do adhan and iqama, you have by mistake, or then it's fine. If you don't do it intentionally, you have done something haram, but your prayer is still valid because it's not a condition. He never said if someone doesn't do adhan, his prayer is invalid. There is no prayer for someone who doesn't do adhan. The way he said there is no prayer for someone who doesn't do wudu. So there is difference between just an order, mutlaq order, general order, and a condition. It is an obligation to say Bismillah because of the hadith that Nasa'i narrated when you do wudu. But if you don't do it, the wudu is still valid. Whether you do it, you don't do it intentionally or by mistake, by forgetting. The next hadith is the hadith is narrated by Talha ibn Musarrif from his father, from his grandfather. He said, I saw Allah Messenger rinsing his mouth and sniffing water up his nose and then blowing it out with separate scoops of water. Now, if you remember the hadith that we mentioned before, from Uthman, from Ibn Abbas, from Ali ibn Abi Talib, they all say that the Prophet used to take water, one scoop of water, and then he washes his mouth and his nose at one time, like this, putting water in his mouth and when one scoop of water. This hadith here says that he saw this man here from his father, grandfather, who is supposedly to be Sahabi, that he saw the Prophet doing it from two different scoops, like taking water, washing the mouth, and taking another scoop for the nose. This hadith here is da'if. This hadith is narrated by Layth ibn Abi Sulaym, who is unanimously da'if, and Talha ibn Musarrif from his father, from his grandfather, Ahmed ibn Hanbal say, I heard Sufyan ibn Uyayna say, who is this Talha ibn Musarrif from his grandfather, from his father? And in the books of hadith of men, they always say, like Abdul Haqq Ishbili or Ibn Hajar or Ibn Hazm or Al-Qattan, they all say this man is unknown, him and his father and his grandfather. So this hadith is da'if. But still, if someone choose to do wudu, to wash his mouth and his nose from different scoops, it's still, there is nothing to make it haram, or to make it, for example, to say, nobody can say this is invalid. everybody agrees it's valid, but this is not the way the Prophet used to do it. This is the best, not the best way to do it, because the Prophet, when he has done wudu one time, the wudu that we described before, and when he finished this wudu, his wudu, he said, whoever does wudu like my wudu, and then pray to rak'ah, Allah will forgive his sins as long as he doesn't think about anything in his wudu during his prayer. Doesn't talk to himself during prayer. It means he will be doing khushu' in his prayer. What's khushu'? Again?
Tranquility.
Tranquility. Thinking about the prayer, about the meaning of Quran and stuff. Yes, and then narrated Ali regarding the description of wudu of the Prophet. He said, he rinsed his mouth and cleaned his nose, sniffing up the water and then blowing it out three times. He sniffed up and blew his nose with the same hand from which he took the water. This hadith is narrated by Abu Dawud and Nasa'i. This hadith is sahih in Abu Dawud and Nasa'i. It's not sahih. He said that the Prophet used to take water to wash his mouth and nose, and you see, when you do what we call istinshaq, this is istinshaq, sniffing water up and then do this what we call istinthaq, blowing up, huh? The hadith of Ali ibn Abi Talib say that the Prophet used to do it with one hand, smell like this, with the right hand sniffing, and then with the right hand again, the same hand. Not many people do it with the right hand and then with the left hand. This is the only hadith sahih concerning this matter here. And then the following hadith narrated Abdullah bin Zayd regarding the ablution of the Prophet. He said the Prophet put his hand in the utensil or the vessel, rinsed his mouth and cleaned his nose from one scoop of water, sniffing it up and blowing it out. He did that three times. That Abdullah ibn Zayd, this hadith is narrated by Bukhari. This hadith, one of the sahih hadith about the wudu of the Prophet. That he used to, he put his hand in the vessel and then did istinshaq. He took the water, sniffed the water, and put the water in his mouth with one scoop. This just contradicts the hadith that we Talha ibn Musarrif from his father, from his grandfather. The hadith weak. Anyway, so this hadith contradicts that hadith anyway.
Is it okay, like, you know, you said earlier that even though that hadith is weak about taking it one at a time,
yeah,
you can still do it, but is it also, say for example, you take two hands, instead of scooping one hand, you take two hands and you, like that, is that alright?
Yeah, all these are actions.
Okay.
So, it's still fine, yeah. It's just not the best thing to do. Yeah.
So you can take a hadith
daif? No, we're not taking any hadith daif. We're taking generally the ayah. The ayah says that you have to wash. The ayah says wash your face. Doesn't say wash your face with one hand, with two hands. You can't just put your face under the tub and let water running. That's still washing. So we are just talking about what's the best way to do it. But
does it matter if you do mouth then nose or nose and mouth?
It doesn't really matter, because there is nothing about washing. You wash your mouth and your nose, this is because it comes in the face. But there is nothing here special about the mouth and the face, that you have to start with your mouth, then your nose, or nose, or then your mouth. So
there is no an order in that.
Yeah.
Is it alright to, like, urine and swim, like, in water, inside water?
Yeah.
You go inside the water and come out. That's wudu.
It's not wudu, because how are you, when you fall in the water, if you want to do your intention to do wudu, and you are going to fall on your face first, and then with your hands inside, and then with your head afterwards, and then with your feet, that will be okay.
No, I mean,
and Bismillah before that.
Huh? It's not okay because you you are not going to start with the order in order. You can go inside the water and then after you are in the water, for example, you put your face. Yeah, you can do that anyway, and then you can put your hand and then yes.
Sheikh, what if you take a shower? Would that count?
No, that is something probably that it comes later. But if you take shower, if you don't do wudu during the shower, if you don't do wudu during the shower, then after you have finished the shower, you have to do wudu. But if you do wudu with the intention, okay, I'm doing wudu and shower in the same time, so you do the area of wudu and then you pour water on the rest of the body, that will be enough. This is what the Prophet used to do. If you choose to do shower just by jumping inside the water, then you have to do wudu later. This is not the opinion of the majority. However, this is the strong opinion, because the way Allah ordered us to do shower, take shower, He ordered us to do wudu, and one shouldn't cover for the other. Yes, so the following hadith, the next hadith is the hadith of Anas ibn Malik. Narrated by Anas, the Prophet saw a man on whose foot appeared a portion like the size of a fingernail, which was not touched by water. He then said, "Go back and perform your wudu ablution properly." Reported by Abu Dawud and the Nasa'i. This hadith is reported by Abu Dawud and the Nasa'i that the Prophet saw someone. The Prophet saw someone who has done wudu, but on his body there was like a mark, almost as big as a fingernail, small mark, that has not been touched by water, on the place of wudu, on his feet, very small area. Then he said, "Arja fa'ahsin wudu'ak," go back and perfect. What did he say here? Go back and perform your wudu ablution properly, or perfect your wudu. Yes.
Is there one about the size of a coin? That a mark was left about the size of a coin.
Yeah, that is the hadith of dirham qadra. That's hadith of the Ahnaf. That is the hadith that Abu Hanifa uses a lot, and he does qiyas about that hadith for everything. That hadith is almost covers all a book of Akum Sarah Tabakat. That hadith covers the book of the Ahnaf in everything. Like if someone has blood in his clothes, if someone more than a coin, if someone has najasa on his body more than a coin, and yeah, but that hadith is da'if. Ahmed, that hadith is called dirham, dam qadra dirham. There is a hadith called that a man, the Prophet saw someone with blood almost as coin on his clothes. Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, "I was sitting with the man that narrated the hadith of the dirham, of the blood almost as big as coin." He said, "I was looking at my side right, to my sides, fearing that someone will see me in that area with that man." He didn't want people to see him with that person. Okay. That person is a liar. That hadith is made up. Anyway, narrated by Anas, the Prophet saw a man on whose foot appeared a portion like the size of a fingernail, which was not touched by water. He then said, "Go back and perform your wudu properly." This hadith, Abu Dawud, after narrating this hadith, he said, "This hadith is not known from the hadith of Jarir ibn Hazim. This hadith is as almost he wants to say it's da'if." Jarir ibn Hazim, the narrator of this hadith from Jarir ibn Hazim is Abdullah ibn Wahab, who is trustworthy, thiqa. And this hadith, he narrated it from Qatada. Qatada is thiqa, and he said, "Haddathana Anas." So there is no problem about, there is no fear from his tadlis here. So this hadith is sahih, and this hadith should be sahih according to the condition of Bukhari. Some people, some book of fiqh prefer to bring the hadith which is narrated by from Jabir from Umar bin Khattab, which is in Muslim, and it's really when you see here he brought this hadith which is not for in Muslim, but normally generally Ibn Hajar will bring first hadith if it's in Bukhari or Muslim. If there isn't, then he will bring from the other books. But here he brought this hadith which is in Abu Dawud, and he left the hadith which is in Muslim. Allahu alam why, but he has made the right choice, because the hadith which is in Abu Dawud is the chain of narrators are all trustworthy, even if Bukhari and Muslim choose not to narrate this hadith. The hadith that is narrated by Jabir bin Abdullah from Umar bin Khattab, that the Prophet saw someone who didn't do his wudu properly, and then he told him to go and do his wudu properly. This hadith is narrated by Abu Zubair from Jabir, and Abu Zubair testified about himself that he said that he is mudallis, according to Layth ibn Sa'd.
So the chain from Abu Dawud was more authentic than the
chain in Muslim. So it is an obligation. From this hadith we understand that it's an obligation when to take shower or want to wash something, to cover every inch, not to leave any area with no touched water, not touched by water. So if you do wudu and afterwards you discover that there is a bit of space that has not been touched by water, you have to do the wudu again. Yes?
So when someone does wudu and then misses the spot unintentionally, and he or she does their first salah, then after that does voluntary salah, would the voluntary salah make up for the missed spot in wudu?
No. If you finish the prayer,
yeah,
and you know for sure,
no,
that...
You don't know.
No?
Yes.
No, if you don't know, you don't know now.
You pay the Fulajju Salah.
You?
You pay the Fulajju Salah.
The
Fulajju Salah.
Nawafil.
Yeah.
No, the Nawafil will not correct something that is wrong. The wudu is a condition. You have to do it in the right way.
Yeah.
So if you don't do the wudu in the proper way, your prayer is invalid. Now, if after you have done wudu and prayer, let's say it's cold, It's a rainy day where the body doesn't dry quickly, and you can see that your body is still wet, but you can see one area that is dry, and definitely this area has not been touched by water, you have to do wudu again and do the prayer again. So this is the hadith. There is another hadith from Khalid bin Ma'dan, from a man of the Sahaba, from a Sahabi, from a man who was the companion of the Prophet, that the Prophet saw a man who prayed, finished his prayer, and then, but there was a mark on his body, on his foot, that has not been touched by water. Then he told him, go and repeat your wudu. Look at the difference between this, repeat your wudu, and look at the difference of this hadith, which is narrated by Abu Dawud and the one in Muslim. He said, go and perfect your wudu. Perform properly your wudu. The hadith, which is da'if from Khalid ibn Ma'dan, says that we have to do the wudu from the beginning. You understand? But no, there is nothing to say that you have to do wudu straight away, like you have to do wudu one after the other. Like, I wash my hands, my face, then my hands straight away, then my head, then... If you stop during the wudu for any reason, you can continue your wudu. You don't have to do it again. Someone washed his face, his hands, and then something came up, and he is busy doing it, and then want to now to do it, to finish his wudu. He can just wipe his head and wash his feet. There is nothing that to say that you have to do it straight, one after the other.
Some people say if it dries.
Yeah, that is an madhahib. That is an opinion. You see, if it dries, if the Prophet didn't say it, then nobody can say it. The Prophet did do wudu. His face, his hands, his head, and then he finished his ghusl, his shower. This is something different, completely different from wudu. Then when he finished, he washed his feet. So here, he did something in between the wudu, in the middle. And there is nothing to say in hadith, in Quran, to say that you have to do it one after the other. So if you do wudu and then you discover afterwards that you have missed something, let's say you do your wudu and then you discover that you have not washed your left hand properly, what you do is you go, you wash your left hand, then you wipe your head again and you wash your feet to make it in order. But you don't have to do the wudu from the beginning.
So is there any time limit? Say for example you...
There is no time limit.
So as long as
the wudu is still valid.
Okay.
As long as you have wudu, you didn't lose your wudu.
So 12 hours could go by and whatever, as long as you don't...
Well, if there is 12 hours, I don't... 12 hours of the night you go to sleep and then you wake up and do wudu again. Okay, well, during the day there is no 12 hours between two prayers.
What about...
Fajr and Dhuhr maybe, yeah.
What about... something that invalidates the wudu whilst you are in the process of making wudu?
You have to start again from the beginning.
No.
Yeah. You have
passing
to start.
Of wind or...
If you lose your wudu at the half of the wudu, you have to start from the beginning.
What, upon Sheikh, what about the two ahadith, let's say the touching of the private parts is...
That is a different subject. Inshallah, we can talk about this after the dars if you want, but...
They say, like you said, you forgot your left hand.
Yeah.
But then you prayed your Fardh prayer.
Yeah.
And then after you remembered that you have to do your wudu and then pray your Fardh prayer again.
Yeah, because when you prayed without wudu. So you have to do your wudu again and then pray again. Unless the prayer is, the time of prayer is gone.
Oh, yeah.
But then you have to read. Do you have to retake it?
Well, we know if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set up limits, yeah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set up limits. He made limits for the prayer, the time of the prayer. And he made a limit for the Hajj or for fasting. You see, if you do Hajj, if you do Hajj now, you go to Hajj. And then you forget something that is a pillar of Hajj. You don't do it. And then the month of Muharram has finished, something that you have to do during the month of Hajj, which is the Qa'dah, the Hijjah, and the Hijjah is finished, what are you going to do? You remember when it's in Sha'ban, you remember. Do you go and to Mecca and do that thing? You don't do it.
No, but when the Prophet says,
you just
Prophet says, إذا نام أحدكم على الصلاة.
جزاك الله خير. Now these limits, Allah سبحانه وتعالى has set up limit for prayer, and He said, like the Prophet said, وقت صلاة الظهر إذا زالت الشمس ما لم يدخل العصر, as long as العصر has not started. And then this is the time of the prayer. Anyone who prays before the time of ظهر, like when the sun is in the middle of the sky, or after the shadow become one more than one, everybody has the shadow, so it has to be the length of the body. When it's more than, start to become more than the length of the body, like for example, if you are 1 meter, your shadow will be 1 meter. So if the shadow is more than that, that is the time of Asr has started. So it's haram to delay prayer beyond that time. You have to pray before that time, and you can't pray before the sun is in the middle of the sky. So this is the time limit. If you pray, you choose to pray before or after, your prayer will be invalid, except where we have a permission from the religion, from the Sharia, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we have to make up for a prayer. Like if you sleep or you forget, the Prophet said, "من نام عن صلاة أو نسيها فليصليها إذا ذكرها." If someone forget the prayer or is sleeping, then he must pray when he remember. You wake up, you pray up. You remember, you pray. So this is one reason where if you delay prayer, you can pray it later, after time. Yes.
How soon, Sheikh? Say, for example, you miss
prayer. When you remember. Just if you remember after a year, you prayed, you didn't pray.
No.
For example, today is a festival, wedding. And then after a year, you are just thinking about the last year, the wedding, I was happy and I didn't pray. You have to stand up straight away and pray it.
No. I've actually in a situation where, say, for example, you missed Fajr.
Yes.
You slept through Fajr.
Yes.
You woke up, say, at 7 o'clock, but you're still tired.
You are, talking about the prayer now, and the brother asked me a question earlier. I didn't want to answer it. I will have to go back to that his question. Okay, what's this? Okay, continue.
Say, for example, Fajr. You missed Fajr. At 7 o'clock was the Fajr time.
Yeah.
At 9 o'clock you woke up, but you're tired.
Yeah.
You didn't want to wake up. Can you wake up at 12 o'clock?
We didn't want to wake up.
No. Just so you're still feeling tired.
Yeah.
You still under the dress.
I missed the Salah. I pray when I wake up.
No, you shouldn't. When you wake up, you have to stand up straight away and pray. You stand, of course, you will have to go to do wudu and. There are now some reasons that will make you delay the prayer. Even if you are afraid, even if there is a fear that the time will finish. For example, if someone really need to go to the toilet, the Prophet said, or someone really need to, the food is prepared and you are going to eat, you delay the prayer for that reason. As the brother said, if you forget prayer or you are sleeping. The other reason, if someone is really sleepy, that he can't even understand what he is saying. This is someone who is intoxicated. He didn't choose to be intoxicated, but he is sleeping to the point that he doesn't know what he is saying. The Prophet said, if someone is sleepy, feels sleep on his prayer, he must go to sleep. Until he knows what he is saying, because he might go, want to make dua, and he will start insulting himself. Now, another reason why you can delay the prayer is intoxication. It's haram to take any kind of intoxication, but if someone takes intoxication, then it's haram for him to pray until the intoxication goes away. This is. For the ayah, لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى. Don't approach prayer while in state of intoxication. حتى تعلموا ما تقولون. Until you know what you are saying. That intoxication includes here sleeping. Because someone who is asleep, who doesn't know what he is saying, he is intoxicated. Doesn't say whether you have choose to be intoxicated or it happened to you. In these reasons here, you make up for the prayer. As soon as these things have, as soon as you wake up, as soon as the intoxication is gone away, as soon as you remember the prayer,
then it will be accepted even if it's outside the time.
Yes, because there is a permission from Allah. For any other reason, the prayer, you can't make up for the prayer.
How about the hadith?
You see the scenario he said where you wake up. And then you still think, I mean, just another 2 hours, then your prayer won't be accepted.
If you know what you are doing,
yes,
and there's just I am a little bit tired, then it will be haram to do that. You will have to stand up and pray
and
then.
If you don't, and you go back to sleep for another 2 hours, then.
If you go back to sleep,
yeah,
knowing what you are doing, you are still fully.
Conscious.
You are conscious,
yeah.
Then your prayer will be enough.
And the delay for this is the delay for this is in Quran. Eh?
The Prophet said, the Prophet was missed prayer when he was in a journey. Yeah. Hadith of Abu Abdullah bin the Hadith of Abu Qatada. When he was in a journey, then they overslept all of them. Then they woke up and then they prayed. When they finished the prayer, the Prophet said. فَمَنْ نَامَ عَنْ صَلَاتٍ أَوْ نَسِيَهَا. So whoever, he said a statement, and then at the end he said, whoever forget prayer or sleep, then he must pray as soon as he remembers. لَكَفَّارَةَ in one riwaya, لَكَفَّارَةَ لَهَا إِلَّا ذَلِكَ. There is no kafara. What is kafara?
Expiation.
For it except this. So if you don't pray it in that time, as soon as you remember, then it will have, there is no kafara for it.
And it doesn't count for the, this does not count for the one who's ignorant, no? For the one who did not know.
What's the one who didn't know, mm-hmm. when he tells, if someone doesn't know and doesn't pray,
mm-hmm.
he forgot, no. He woke up now after sunrise,
mm-hmm.
and then he said, okay, I missed the prayer anyway, I'm going to sleep. Mm-hmm. So he woke up.
Mm-hmm.
He woke up after 4 hours, 5 hours, and he tells you, okay, this is what I have done. You tell him you have done wrong, but you don't have to pray now. Next time, don't do it, because okay. that is not time for prayer.
Sure. Didn't tell me, because I told you when you miss your, yeah, the brother said when you miss the left hand, you didn't do it in wudu.
Yeah.
So you have to pray hatta if even if.
No, he didn't forget the prayer. He made a mistake about his hand. He didn't forget the prayer. He remembered the prayer and he prayed it. Huh? He prayed it the wrong way. Huh? Mm-hmm. You see, if someone, I give you an example. Someone has janaba, for example,
mm-hmm.
and he forgot to take shower, and he prayed for not one day, for a month. He didn't know that he had Jannah, and then after a month he remembered, but he never took shower. And the whole month he was praying without shower. What does he do?
A month.
Pray them back.
Pray the month?
Yep.
Yeah. No.
Yeah. No, he shouldn't pray. He doesn't have to pray. Huh? He prayed and he made a mistake. So he shouldn't pray. There is different opinions here, but we do follow just the Quran and Hadith.
So
there is nothing to say. The man here didn't forget the prayer. He forgot to take shower.
Mm. The Hadith of the pen is lifted from three. Is this sahih?
This Hadith, yes.
So you can use this also. The sleeping person is one of the people that is the pen is lifted.
Yeah, his pen. The pen is lifted as long as he is sleeping. When he wakes up, the pen starts writing.
So I'm saying, so yeah. You can.
So this. Knowledge people, ulama,
yeah.
They're telling people, oh, as you start praying at 18 or 20, you have to pray the rest of the years.
Oh, this is some of the madhab say this, actually. Actually, this is not the ahnaf, this is the majority. Sometimes, some fuqaha, when they say this, it's almost not like, sometimes it's opinion based on. Okay, if we don't say this, when people know this, they will be afraid, they will not delay their prayers. You see some people that say, okay, I'm going to be good in the future. So they say, okay, if we don't tell them this, they will say we will be good in the future. But if he knows that if he need to be good in the future, he must make up for the previous, he will more be more careful. This is not the way to talk about religion.
Mm-hmm.
If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need help. Hmm? If he wants everybody to be perfect, everybody to be good, he knows how to perfect his religion. We shouldn't lie and say, you have to, you see, when you say you have to, you are saying that Allah made it an obligation to. Hmm? And you shouldn't lie about about Allah. It's haram. I go back to the brother because he asked a question, and because I went out of the subject, I will have to go with him. Do you say it about someone? Actually, I try to avoid it for some other reasons, not for this, but go ask a question.
I don't mind, Sheikh.
Yeah, no, just inshallah. What is the question? Someone with doing.
I read to
touching
a long time ago.
Yeah.
And then this is when I used to. Anything I read in the Sahih from Albani, I would take it. So I read that there was two hadith conflicting against each other. One saying that the wudu is broken if you touch the private parts and with the palm of the hand, and another that said it didn't. Prophet ﷺ said it's just part of your body.
Yes.
And apparently, from what I read, according to Albani, this he said that it does break the wudu. He took the hadith that said it does break the wudu and.
Yes,
so I was
the hadith that says it does bring the wudu is the hadith narrated by Urwa ibn Zubair from Busra ibn Safwan.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever said this hadith is sahih, there is now they say Bukhari.
Mm-hmm.
Some books you say Bukhari say it's da'if.
Mm-hmm.
In some books Bukhari say it's sahih.
Mm-hmm.
Now whoever said this hadith is da'if,
mm-hmm.
is because of Urwa ibn Zubair narrated this hadith from Marwan ibn al-Hakam.
Mm-hmm.
Marwan bin Hakam is supposed to be a Sahabi, but he is the one who fought against Abdullah bin Zubair, and people for that reason consider him not. There are a lot of stories about him. That's why people don't consider him to be trustworthy. The truth is, there is nothing, even though he was not like, he did not do the best things, like fighting against Abdullah bin Zubair, or, but there is nothing that you can hold against him, like to be, to make him not, to make him a fasiq. There is no such thing from trustworthy person who can testify against him, but we can accept. There is stories about people, but people exaggerate about the people they don't like. And his fight against Abdullah bin Zubair is like the fight of Muawiyah against Ali bin Abi Talib. Everybody has his own ta'wil. Still, if the hadith states clearly, you see the narrator of the hadith is Urwa bin Zubair, the brother of Abdullah bin Zubair, who this man had fought against. And he didn't meet him after his brother, after the he had the fight with his brother. At the time, the man was known to be trustworthy, no matter what happens later. What he narrated when he was trustworthy, it will still be accepted. The other thing is, there is one narration that probably is not very famous, but it is with the chain of narrators that are trustworthy. This narration says that Abdullah, that Urwa bin Zubair, after he heard this from Marwan bin al-Hakam, he went himself to Busra bin Safwan, and she narrated this hadith to him, which says that whoever touches his private part, not really private part, but yeah, من مس ذكره فليتوضأ. This is just for men. Men, women don't come under this hadith, because we don't call the word say من مس ذكره فليتوضأ. This is the other narrations which include, like says, private parts, and these narrations are narration with the meaning. Yeah, the Prophet, this is how the Prophet said. Now when we have the hadith that says two hadith contradicting each other, we always say there is something called going with the ma'hud al-asl. And ma'hud al-asl meaning what generally, like this, if something haram in Sharia and not haram, we find hadith that says haram, another hadith says it's not haram, says it's not an obligation, and it says an obligation. You go with the one that says an obligation. You go with the one that says it's haram. Why? Because generally everything is not haram, it is halal. Generally everything is not an obligation. So when the Prophet, when someone comes to the Prophet and asks about anything that is not haram, he will say it's not haram. When he says haram, that is something that came in you, addition to the religion. So you can't say this has been abrogated again. So everything is not an obligation. Where it became an obligation, you can't say now it's not an obligation, except with the proof of Dalil. I give you an example. Now the Prophet, it's allowed to go to the graveyard, but the Prophet forbade people from going to the graveyards. When he said, when he wanted to tell them that they can't go to the graveyard, he said it this way: I have forbidden you from going to the graveyard, now go to the graveyards. I have forbidden you from drinking in the vessels, drink in any vessel. I have forbidden you from holding the flesh of the sacrifice for more than 3 days. Now you can keep your, you understand? So it has to be clear when something has abrogated twice, like abrogated and then abrogated again, it has to be clear this way. You just, other ways, anything you just always go against which is the normal. The normal, mahud, what we call mahud al-asl, the asl, the origin, everything is not an obligation. So you always, if you find no obligation, obligation, you go with obligation. Everything is halal. So if something is halal and haram, we go for haram rather than halal, because everything was halal at the beginning. So here this hadith, we have to take the hadith of Busra bin Safwan, someone who touches himself in that way, that he must take the wudu. The hadith of Busra bin Safwan, she said that the Prophet said, من مس ذكره فليتوضأ. You see, it breaks wudu, yeah? What about someone who went to toilet while he forgot? He forgot and he went to toilet. Does he would not do the wudu? Understand?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. So if someone forget, it doesn't make any difference. You have to understand here, so take that عُفِيَ رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا وَأَخْطَأْنَا. Mistakes are forgiven. Yes. So if someone forget and touches himself, he's fine. If someone forget and loses his wudu, he's fine. But the ayah is not about forgetting or not forgetting. It is about if you forget, do wudu. You see, it's not one thing here. It's two. If this happen, do this. Yeah. If you forget, if you lose wudu, do wudu. If you touch yourself, if you touch your private part, do wudu. Huh? It's like ولا تأكلوا مما لم يذكر اسم الله عليه. Don't eat from what Allah's name has not been mentioned on. So if someone slaughter something and he doesn't mention the name of Allah, we say it's not haram. You have not done nothing wrong. You have forgotten. But it's dead. You can't eat it. It's dead meat. This, put this, because this is here, the majority contradict. This majority say if he has forgotten, it's fine, he can eat. But they don't say if he forgot and loses his wudu, he can pray. It's the same wording. Don't eat from what Allah name has not been mentioned. Don't pray if you don't have wudu. So this is a condition.
So
yeah.
You say it's not for
women? No. Because dhakarahu, the word dhakar, it's not for women. So
male genital.
No?
It's called male genital.
Yeah. So there is, there are
dalk in wudu.
Dalk, that is for the malikis.
Maliki.
Only.
No hadith on it.
There is no hadith about it. Dalk, there is hadith da'if that we mentioned last week. The Abd al-Rahman. Yes. There is nothing to say. Washing, if you go under the rain, and the rain, you do your intention to take shower, and there is, it's raining, your shower is complete. If you go under, if you turn the shower on and stand up under the shower and the water is coming on your body, as long as every inch on your body is covered, then your water, your ghusl is complete. It's only the Malikis who say that there is dark. Yeah, the majority contradict Malik here. Yes.
Is there ikhtilaf?
We have stopped this here. You can
ikhtilaf in what? Is there ikhtilaf in masalaka?
Yeah, the majority actually say that whoever touches his private part doesn't have to take the shower to do wudu. That is the majority opinion. The majority don't take this hadith, either because many of them don't know this hadith, and some of them know the other hadith, and they took the other hadith.
I mean, like for ladies too.
No, for everybody who says that, everybody who said that you have to do wudu for this reason, that you they say man and woman, but then you take the hadith which says that the Prophet has ordered أَمَرَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ بِالْوُضُوءِ مِنْ مَسِّ الْفَرْجِ, that Allah, and then you see here this is not the wording of the Prophet, this is here someone narrating this hadith that the Prophet has ordered. You see, the Prophet has ordered. The Prophet will not say the Prophet has ordered. The Prophet said the statement. تَوَضَّأُ مَنْ مَسَّ ذَكَرَهُ فَلْيَتَوَضَّأُ. This is what the Prophet has said. And someone narrate the hadith in his own words, in the, but he understand from it, change one word for another. The first word has a meaning, the other word is completely different. This is not what the Prophet has ordered us to do. The Prophet said, بَلِّغُوا لِيُبَلِّغِ الشَّاهِدُ الْغَائِبَ لِيُبَلِّغِ الشَّاهِدُ الْغَائِبَ فَلَعَلَّ فَرُبَّ مُبَلَّغٍ أَوْ عَامٍ مِنْ شَاهِدٍ أَوْ لَعَلَّ بَعْضَ مَنْ بَلَغَهُ أَنْ يَكُونَ أَوْعَى لَهُ مِمَّنْ سَمِعَهُ. Some of the people who will hear, who will not hear my statement directly, might understand it better than those who have heard it from me. That's why he ordered them to transmit the message the way they heard it, the wording of the Prophet. It's the wording of the Prophet are protected because it's dhikr. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. So we have always to go back to the wording of the Prophet rather than the understanding of some people.
So you're saying the hadith of the touching the woman?
Yeah. The woman touching her private tab. There is no such hadith.
So the ulama who say even if the husband touches his wife, there something is breaking wudu. This is qiyas, no?
No, touching the wife, that is different story.
There is the dalil for this.
That is a different story. That is something that I prefer not to talk about now because it will take some time before. Sure. But it will be coming, inshallah, with the nawaqid al-wudu, about things that breaks wudu.
Okay.
I just quickly finish this hadith. Narrated Allah Messenger used to perform, narrated Anas, Allah Messenger used to perform ablution with one mud of water and perform ghusl bath with one sa' to five mud of water. This is just how much water you can use. There is a hadith that is very famous, that you shouldn't spoil water, even if you are at the edge of a river. That hadith is da'if. It is haram to spoil anything anyway,
to waste anything.
However, you use what you can, what you need, and that's all. And then the following hadith is narrated by Umar. Allah Messenger said, if one of you perform ablution thoroughly, then recite the following supplication. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله إلا فتحت then the gate of Jannah will be open for him. This hadith is narrated by Muslim. Some people have said this hadith is ضعيف, however they didn't show any strong evidence for that. Daraqutni, one of them. This hadith is narrated by Muslim and Tirmidhi, and Tirmidhi added to it, اللهم اجعلني من التوابين واجعلني من المتطهرين. Tirmidhi, after narrated this addition here, he said that there is nothing, not much strong strength in the hadith that are mentioned regarding this subject. It's mean dua that you make after the. So this hadith, Allahumma ja'alni min at-tawwabin ja'alni min at-tahhirin, narrated by someone called al-Miswar ibn al-Muwarri', unknown. And all the hadith is muftarib, is mixed up and mistake.
Is it wajib to say that dua afterwards?
No. If anyone says it, the Prophet didn't say it. He said whoever says it, the doors of the gate of Jannah will be open for him.
So,
لَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ.
And that's sahih.
Yes.
Sheikh, was in there in addition to that dua as well?
No, that's why.
وَجْعَلْنِ مِنْ عِبَادِكَ
الصَّالِحِينَ. No. Well, this is the hadith that is narrated by Muslim. Just this part. And yes. You think?
Yeah, about the limit the Prophet said, once you forget Salah, wasn't there a hadith that said, even if you forget 20 years afterwards and you remember,
Well, the hadith, brother, that you tell me are not in my books.
Yeah.
So you have to tell me from where you get them. after 20 years, let me just think. About 20, I'm just saying 20 years. I know about hadith that says 10 years, that the mud is the tayammum of a Muslim as long as he doesn't find water. If he finds water after 10 years, he must touch his body with it. But 20 years, I can't even think of anything about 20 years now. Inshallah. It's time of prayer, yeah?
The method of filling up with the bugs, what's happening in this country, is quite a waste of time. That's not a good way to
read. Maybe.
It is.
As long as someone.
Many people are taking the last word, no?
They fill up the bugs.
What if someone has swimming pool?
It's even worse.
Well, he's going to enjoy learn to swim and as long as he's doing something with it, it's not
constructive. Come on, cut.